Okay, first of all, I would like to thank the press for being here today, for SMU, The Daily Reporter, Sioux City, KTIV, and Des Moines, WHO, for being here and getting the word out to the citizens of Spencer. First of all, I'd like to also thank everyone standing behind me for the diligent efforts in helping the citizens of Spencer and to restore vital services. And I'd like to, at this point, introduce the people behind me. First on my right is Fire Chief Jesse Colson, Public Works Director Mark White, Emergency Management Eric Tigges, Chief of Police Mark Warburton, Police Lieutenant Kyle Van Otterloo, SMU CEO Steve Pick, and the Chamber CEO, and the person who's been heading up our volunteer services and our sheltering services, Sharifa Jones. They've been working tirelessly for the past 24 to 36 hours, and will be working nonstop in the future. Just for background purposes, city staff, county emergency management met Friday afternoon to make plans to prepare for a flood with a crest of about 17 and a half feet. Obviously, the river crested at a much higher and faster level, and the city and all emergency teams had to pivot and switch gears as the flood reached epic proportions. With that said, the city has established emergency shelters at Crosswinds Church at the North Mall, Pentecostal Church south of the river. We've been working with various organizations to help provide food, water, cots, blankets, etc. We're very, very grateful for the help of all those who volunteered their services. Our emergency response crews helped evacuate hundreds of Spencer citizens to shelter. Police, fire, DNR crews, dispatchers have done an outstanding job. I know that everyone is concerned about what the future holds and have many questions concerning water, electric power, sewer systems, travel in the city and out of the city. That's why I've asked the folks behind me to answer specific questions that they will be better equipped to answer than me. I want to thank you for helping us get the word out to the citizens of Spencer, and with that, I'll be glad to answer your questions.
So, a lot of people in your town don't know how to get out of town. You know, I get out. So, you can't get out of town, yes or no?
Yeah, the question was, people want to know, can they get out of town? And so, I think that Eric Tagus from Emergency Management will probably be equipped to answer that. I think a lot of the folks back here would be. My short answer is, yes, you can get out of town. It's a circuitous route, but Eric?
Yes, sir. So the road situation is obviously fluctuating. We've crested, and so the roads are beginning to open up. Spencer, North Spencer is still very isolated from South Spencer, which brings up some logistical issues for us. But yes, you can get where you're going. It's just going to take a roundabout route. But we are hopeful that as the waters continue to recede and repair crews go out, that that the roads become more accessible, and we can obviously bring more resources in and stuff in a more timely manner. So East 18th Street can bring you north around the floodwaters on Highway 71, and then yes, you would exit further north if you take the East Beltway, correct? However, the East Beltway going south is still impassable.
Okay. Any other questions for any of the folks up here? George. Yes, we do, and our crews, our fire crews, and our help from the DNR did a marvelous job, and I'd like to bring Fire Chief Jesse Colson up here to talk specifically about that.
Give you a little rundown of what happened. This started for us at Saturday morning at 5:15 with our first rescues. We had two people in a submerged vehicle just north of town off the highway. Recognizing water levels were rising, we took a look south and we actually started to separate our staffing. And we did a south. We staffed rigs south of town, knowing that water was going to rise and it was going to delay our response or actually create no response for us. So we separated our staff right away Saturday morning. So we established a south command and a north command for that. Rescue started then at 5:15. By 17:15, by 5:15 in the evening, we had an all clear from both sides of the river, a few blocks. During that time, we conservatively rescued 383 people. 73 of them are on the north side, 310 of them are on the south side. We had two rescued by the Air National Guard off of a vehicle top out of the river. We are, again, that's conservative. That's what we tried to track. Who knows who else was involved and who else got extracted. Just some of the departments that helped us, Algona, Arnold's Park, Manson, Webb, Royal, and several other departments were a part of that, including the DNR, conservation, and multiple other agencies all performed those rescues. But again, that was a conservative number. We'll see if we can get some better numbers. At this time, we had a vehicle that was submerged that we're working with yet. Otherwise, every rescue and all our searching that was reported to us has been accounted for. If there is any unaccounted for people, they have not been reported to us yet. We have an unaccounted for person there in that with that vehicle yet. So we're waiting on confirming that, but we got to wait for waters to subside. Not that we're aware of. No, we've responded to every call for service, and every time we've went, either someone had already rescued, self-rescued, or we rescued them. So any calls for service or rescue, we've managed. We have none unanswered.
Do you have a breakout on homes, businesses damaged, underwater questions?
No, not at this point. We don't. That is going to be one of the things that we're going to be assessing as we move forward. I just saw the governor's press release that she's having a press conference at 3 o'clock, I believe, this afternoon at the EOC in Johnston. And but I haven't heard any specifics as to where she's going or anything else about her press conference.
What would you want the people rallied on? I know Rock Valley's got a lot of coverage, and maybe not so much, but what would be your message?
Well, our message is that we're going to recover from this, that our crews have been outstanding in the work that we've done so far. We've got a lot of work to do moving forward, but Spencer has recovered from things before. We have a very, very good citizenry, very proud citizenry, and we will recover, and we will get back to normal. No, I don't. Yeah, the question was when will businesses downtown be ready to reopen? And I think that's really a question with regard to power. And for that, I'm going to turn the mic over to Steve Pick from Spencer Municipal Utilities, and he can better answer that question.
Thank you for that. On our electric system, we still have many customers without power. We have restored some customers this morning, so we're still working towards getting everybody back on, which is very difficult with the amount of flooding we have going on. Right now, we're pumping record amounts of water, and we're going to begin valving off sections of town this afternoon, trying to eliminate some of the leaks that we have in our water system. On the communications front, our phone switch was down yesterday. We moved everything over to another switch located in the area, and we're bringing lines currently back up at this time.
And how long the sewer is going to be down? I know it said 24 to 48 initially. Any other projections on that?
Yeah, the question was how long perhaps will the sewer system be down, and that's a great question. And as of right now, the sewer system is inoperable, and we're asking citizens not to use the toilets, not to use the showers, etc., because it just puts a whole strain on the system. But to answer the specifics of that, I'll turn it over to Mark White, our Public Works Director.
The wastewater treatment plant was swamped with river level, so currently Veolia is our contract operator, and they have people that have come in from all over the country that are on site and still continue to come in to help Public Works with that situation. They're pumping large areas right now to try to get just an idea or magnitude of the damage, but even the headworks was swamped, including all of the valves and equipment in the basement. So first thing we do is start pumping off the clarifiers and raw sewage coming in. Of course, that's a bypass to the river at this time. We cannot give an estimate. All the electric motors will have to be baked and dried and checked, and we certainly have lots of crews coming in. We continue to maintain a minimal level of service throughout the community with the lift stations, approximately 11 lift stations. Most of the lift stations actually continue to function at a high level, meaning a high water level in the wet well with alarms going on. The other ones, we were able to bypass and run gasoline pumps through the night. That takes just kind of enough off of pressure off of the system to maintain a very, very limited amount of service. Just keep in mind that when it gets into the pipe, there's nowhere for it to go right now unless it's pumped out somewhere. It just simply can't get into the plant. But I believe we'll be able to give a better idea or answer at the end of the day as far as the length. I believe it will, yes.
And to that, with regard to Mark's comment, with regard to a better idea of when we'll be able to pick up service, we've been having command meetings basically every 2 to 3 hours to assess where we've been and what we need to do going forward to restore services and operations within the city. And we plan to have another meeting, I believe it's at 3 o'clock today, where we will be assessing the situation. And Mark may have a better answer for you at that time with regard to the sewer system. And after every one of those command meetings, we will be putting out and have been putting out press releases. So expect to get another press release from us probably around the 4 o'clock hour. Okay, the question was, were there any incidents last night that PD had to take care of? And we did establish a curfew within the city from 10:30 at night until 6 in the morning to reduce that traffic so that we can have our response crews be available and not be impeded by anything. And we are going to establish that curfew again tonight from 10:30 until 6 a.m. But to answer your specific question, I'll turn it over to Chief.
Yeah, we had some reports of that happening. However, I think those were misinformation. Due to the floodwaters, there's a lot of people walking and wandering around up on people's yards and different places that they are normally not. And so obviously this calls for suspicion, and so people are calling in. So we appreciate the calls for service and the calls into the police department, but right now that has not been substantiated, no.
Yeah, Yeah, I'm going to, the question was what needs to be done for residents to get back into their homes. And I'm going to defer that question to Eric Tigas, our emergency management person.
So that's a very fluid question, but obviously the floodwaters got to go down. This morning as we took a gauge, we were at 20.18. The all-time record before yesterday was 20.12. And so we still have a lot of water going around. We need to drop, conservatively 3 to 4 feet, be in the 17 to 16 foot range before we can even really get in and start doing assessments. So before people are going to be able to go into that house, we need to, and we're aware of, that there's going to be electrical transformers that were underwater. There's going to be natural gas pipes that had broken. There's going to be all these things that are all going to need to be vetted before we can start allowing people to come in. And so, we're kind of the Mother Nature is going to kind of dictate that pace for us a little bit, and then we can allow us to do a good assessment of that. We want people to go home more than anything too, and so we just got to make sure it's safe for them to do that. So that's a great question, and the question was what was the river gauge at? So the electronic gauge that the Iowa Flood Center put in was underwater, and so that makes it difficult for us to get an accurate reading. Jim has done a lot of work, and Jim's been with us on a lot of flood fights over the years, and so I really, really trust his numbers. 20.2, Jim, or 22.1. is where we're estimating, and we're going to kind of crunch those numbers a little bit, and Jim and I have a meeting with the National Weather Service to kind of, but when the flood gauge is underwater, it's really high.
How does that compare to 53?
So the high record in 53 was 20.2, so that's 2 feet above 1952, so it's unprecedented.
Yeah, I can speak to that. Not that I was around in 1953 here in Spencer. I was born in 1953, but I wasn't around here to experience that flood. To me, the biggest difference is the infrastructure on the south side of Grand Avenue. We didn't have the commercial development back then. We didn't have as much residential back then. We didn't have near the infrastructure, underground or streets. We didn't have schools in that area. It's much more developed on the south side today than it was in 1953. And would anybody like to add anything to that? Mark?
Yes, sir.
Sure.
During the 1953 flood, there was not the dike on the west side of the highway, so there was smaller levels that could cause problems as well. So that dike system was put in I think 1968 or 69, which has helped us a lot through prior high water events, but just simply wasn't high enough for this one. It was not designed to be a flood control structure. It was built as an emergency situation with the core in preparation of a high snow melt in March, I believe is when that was. So we've got, that's helped us a lot, up to this point, but when you go over the top, and just as the mayor says, none of the area was built up. Hard surface, roofs, driveways, streets, infrastructure, that all creates obviously additional runoff, even though runoff wasn't the main reason we're going backwards with the river here.
Yeah, if I can respond to that first, and the question was with regard to the shelters and the rescue operations and providing food and so forth. Yesterday morning early, we made calls to establish centers on both the south side of the river and the north side of the river, and people opened their doors to us. We initially had to had a shelter center set up at the YMCA, had to relocate that to the Congregational Church and then also to Crosswinds Church. But Sharifa has done just yeoman's work with regard to being in contact with our shelter volunteers, providing food and so forth. But I'll let her answer your specific question, Randy.
Yes, thank you. I reach perfection a little bit before these guys, so I have to move the microphone. So shelters, we do, as the mayor said, we have a shelter on the south side and one on the north side. We did have several shelters on both the south side and the north side prior to today, about 10 a.m. We followed Homeland Security's advice to condense those down to one shelter on the south and one on the north. We are currently using Faith Pentecostal Church on the south, and on the north we are using Crosswinds Church as well. You know, we really just use the business contacts that we had, and obviously locating larger facilities that were at higher ground. Anything else?
How long are those that are remaining open? People are going to be displaced for quite some time.
We're actually in the process of working with Red Cross, and we will start transitioning that over to them. Both the, you know, the tracking of individuals that are at those facilities, and then also making sure those facilities are equipped with what they need, and then working with Red Cross to get those individuals into more permanent locations. And what that is at this point, I don't know yet. Yeah, the question is, what is the immediate need right now for relief? And I'll answer this, and then also the mayor and anyone else. Ultimately, right now, we're still, just because we just transitioned from seven shelters down to two shelters, we're still assessing that. And so what we are asking for, and we're getting information from each of those shelters, is what is needed there. So if there is people, if there are people who can assist, we are asking them to contact us, and you can do that just by following us on social media. We've got an email address out there, and we're collecting contact information as well as what they can provide, so that we can be better equipped in the community, and that we don't have too much of one thing and not enough of another thing. The number in the shelter is about 375 to 400. That's fluctuated a little bit, but that's a pretty steady number. Yeah, so the question was about donations. So the chamber has a foundation. We have set up a foundation or a donation link for people if they would like to make a monetary donation, and that link is on the chamber Facebook page, and all of our partners have been tagged in that. We did this morning early, probably about 6 a.m. ish or earlier, we had a scam donation that was set up, and Jessica Wright with the City of Spencer has handled that, we believe. And so it is, the donation link right now is with the Chamber Foundation. Thank you.
Yeah, in terms of what the city needs from the state or federal officials, Eric Tigas and I were both on the phone yesterday morning early with state officials, asking them for various resources. And Eric is better equipped, I think, at this point to answer where we go from here with regard to our response and what our needs are for specific resources.
So the Iowa Homeland Security Emergency Management has been a great partner for us, a huge partner for us. We've talked to them. They have provided logistical support for us. We had boats that were brought to us by Homeland Security through the DNR. They made a bunch of calls for us to bring cots. Obviously, Rock Valley flooded before we did, and so a lot of Red Cross materials and a lot of actual state resources were already tied up at the Rock Valley flooding, and so we had to kind of pit and patch some stuff together, and Homeland Security was amazing at helping us do that and just bringing resources from lots of areas. They've brought us trash pumps and boats and cots and blankets, everything you could possibly ask. As far as future, you know, we're going to be looking at resources in the for the foreseeable future when we get back into the cleanup and stuff like that. The Iowa National Guard, as Chief Colson mentioned, did some rescue for us yesterday. They were a vital part of our response, and yeah, Homeland Security's been solid for us the entire time. Yeah, no, this is the City of Spencer press conference, but Clay County was impacted. The City of Everly, you can take a pretty big swath of about block and a half wide by 7 blocks long of residences that were all inundated by water. Countless roads, the Clay County literally ran out of barricades trying to barricade up all the roads that had water over the top. There's significant damage throughout Clay County, in all of our communities, and certainly in the rural areas. But not only that, again, Rock Valley flooded, Lyon County flooded. Northwest Iowa, it's usually kind of our friends over in eastern Iowa that have the bigger rivers and they usually have the bigger flooding, but this one 100% belongs to Northwest Iowa. And so we've seen record-setting flood levels on 13 different rivers across Northwest Iowa.
Yeah, that's a good question, Randy, in terms of, you know, when people are starting to get back into their homes, or can they get back into their homes. We have a call center that we have established, but I think that number went down. It may be back up, I'm not sure. But certainly the city, and we're going to be bringing in other people to you know, help answer any questions that people may have with regard to getting back into their homes. And we will be trying to provide the best information that we possibly can to everyone on a timely basis, with regard to what's going on, with regard to electricity, with regard to the sewers, with regard to travel within the community. All of those issues, we'll try and do the best we can. Well, Randy, the question was, it's going to be a long haul. I think it will be, obviously, take some time. The cleanup, I mean, we're going to be talking about cleanup the next few days, how the city is going to manage that cleanup. We've got debris in the streets right now. As the water starts to recede a little bit, and Public Works and our Solid Waste Division is going to be trying to put together a plan for how we do that. And we will get that plan to the press as quickly as we possibly can to alleviate questions that people may have. Yeah. Yeah, I think that I'm going to defer to a more of an expert on that, and I think Mark White is my go-to guy on that question.
We certainly understand the desire. You have a wet basement; it's filled to the top, and it's kind of a transition to get to the next phase. But we strongly caution folks not to move forward with that when the soils are saturated around the foundations. In fact, we plan to try to get out a little press information just along that as well. There was three foundations that were reported this morning that collapsed or failed walls because they were pumped out too soon. So just keep in mind, you know, you have all that pressure coming from the outside. When the pressure's inside, it's equalized. And there's been several foundation problems throughout the whole event, but three may have been accelerated due to aggressive pumping.
Yeah, the question is about our phone service and city water. Okay, and Steve Pick from SMU.
We did start transitioning to a secondary telephone switch this morning. We have active lines, and we're still working on moving more lines, so we're making progress on that. As far as water, what we're up against is we do have a lot of leaks in the system. We know that. We've been able to maintain system pressure. In the event that changes, we would have an immediate press release. At that point in time, the water would no longer be safe to drink. So, as I mentioned earlier, in order to do that, we will start turning off sections of town that are currently flooded and try to identify where those leaking sections are at so we can route water around them.
Sure. Sure. Exactly. Yeah, I will, and I think Sharifa can also address that too. But yeah, basically we have had, and this I think you see in a lot of communities, when there is a disaster, whether it's a flood or whether it's a tornado or whatnot, you see people wanting to help. And we saw that out at the sandbag station yesterday. People filling sandbags for whomever. We had volunteer crews going up to KICD to sandbag their tower so that they could stay on the air. We had Okoboji and Milford have brought down school bus loads full of supplies, food and blankets and pillows and just all sorts of things. And you're right. And I think that one of the things that I said yesterday when I was on the radio was that one of the best things that people can do is just go to their neighbors and see how their neighbors are doing. So Sharifa, would you like to expand on that?
Yeah, as the mayor mentioned, lots of volunteers. The sandbagging, that was especially imperative yesterday. You know, now with the shelters, those have essentially been manned by volunteers, obviously contacts with each of the businesses and or churches. And then now the food. And so we're really just coordinating efforts now to make sure we've got everybody fed for lunch. We're focusing on the evening meal, some dinner meals, and making sure that we are using the resources that we have as best as possible, both within the community and then outside as well.
Yeah, and with regard to those lunches, I think a big shout out to the pork producers, the cattlemen, the Kiwanis, JCs, I think have all been instrumental in helping out with those meals. One thing I would like Eric Tigas to address is I know that the governor, one thing she's going to address in her press conference is declaring us part of a disaster area. And FEMA will be getting involved, and I've never been through that process since I've been elected mayor, but I know Eric has been involved in those kinds of situations. And Eric, can you talk about FEMA a little bit?
So first of all, we've already been the Iowa Individual Assistance Program is a program that the state of Iowa offers to individual residences. There are financial caps and things like that for eligibility. But if you contact Upper Des Moines Opportunity, if you have damage, there is grants up to $5,000 to help assist in recovery through the Iowa Individual Assistance Grant Program. As Mayor Baumgart said, we've had contact with Iowa Homeland Security Management, and we have requested a disaster proclamation for Clay County. Governor Reynolds will address that at her press conference this afternoon, and she's going to be requesting an expedited presidential declaration for the severe flooding in Northwest Iowa. Obviously, that will be up to the federal government and President Biden, but I would anticipate there will be certainly federal assistance that will come down, and perhaps even further individual assistance that would be offered through the federal government.
Thanks, Eric. Any more questions? If not, we will, as I said, all of the people behind me, myself and several others will be meeting at 3 o'clock. We will have an updated press release at about 4 o'clock, and we will continue to keep everyone as informed as we possibly can as we move forward. So I want to thank you guys for coming, and travel safe on your way home.